Even Luther and I have worshipped here, but we have never left worship here. So this is a privilege for us, and we are thankful that you're able to do this. So, after worship, I am told that there is a coffee fellowship hour downstairs, the doors, down to the dining room, and each and every one of you are welcome to join with us.
Thank you.
Eternal God, as we thank you for the wondrous, precious gift of life, we are aware how time slips through our fingers. Caught up in yesterday's dreams and tomorrow's hopes, we pass by the opportunities of today. Grant us the courage to meet those challenges and to open our hearts and minds to those of our lands, tongues, and races. Deliver us from the sins of fear and prejudice, that we may not move away today when all are one together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have come in praise and confession. And when we think about God, and how God reaches out to each one of us through Jesus Christ, know that you are forgiven, and let us rejoice. Amen. I don't know if there are any children here who would like to come down front. I have my teddy bear with me. Thank you. say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and a buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, or the arrow that flies by day, or the pestilence that stalks in darkness, or the destruction that wastes at noonday. Because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, no scourge come near your tent. May God bless the reading of his word.
Let us pray. Oh God, as we struggle with issues of our faith, our concerns, our country, our questions and our doubts, may we be open to your still small voice that may be heard over the chaos of our lives. Amen. When preparing a worship service, most especially a sermon, one tries to find scriptures to go along with what could be called the theme of the day. Well, there's no scripture that I could find that supports celebrating a day which, in 1776, after many months of talking, arguing, compromising, discussing, a group of men joined together and produced a document. A document in which the colonies stated their independence, not only from a rather tyrannical king, King George III, but also from England, their motherland. Well, while there are no scriptures of independence, there are numerous scriptures related to dependence, especially dependence on God, our Creator. Psalm 91, which Joan Freets just read, is one of many. Now, it might seem a bit strange to beginning of the week in which we celebrate our independence from tyranny to talk about dependence. But it is very well to remember that we are very dependent on God who sustains us. I don't know how many of you know, but the United Church of Christ offers daily devotionals online to which we subscribe. Well, for some reason, the devotional of March 3rd, 2017, was written by Tony Robinson. Now, Tony Robinson is an ordained UCC author and speaker. And for some reason, his devotional that day really stayed with me, where it referred to Psalm 91, which will be our focus for today. As you heard, Psalm 91 is full of amazing and outrageous promises by God. It is written, because you have made the Lord your refuge, no evil shall befall you. There will be no tent scourges, whatever they are. You will not fear the terror by night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Well, that all sounds very good, that nothing will harm us. But we know that that is not true. Mr. Robinson writes, I don't think having faith in God and trying to do God's will mean that nothing bad will ever happen to you or to those you love. Because bad things do happen to us. But that does not mean it's because our faith isn't strong enough or we haven't been good enough. Bad things simply happen. He continues, I truly believe these wild promises that God will take care of us. And he knows that bad stuff, way worse than tent scourges, will happen. So both statements are true. Mr. Robinson said, I believe that if we have some trust in the high and holy
bad stuff and whether or not we come up on the other side. In the ancient days, as you all know, a prophet spoke. And there are many wonderful passages in Isaiah which give comfort to those in trouble. Isaiah 40, verse 1, gives comfort to Judea for her many years of trouble. And 41:10 says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not afraid, for I am your God. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand." My favorite really is Psalm 43, verses 1b through 3a. "Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior." Did you notice that in each one of these, there is an acknowledgement that we will face difficult times in our life? God does not deny that at some point bad things will happen. But the prophet says that God will be with us, no matter what happens, no matter where we are, no matter who we are. Now, I don't know about you, but I do know about me. There is a difference in saying, "I will protect you," meaning I have a structure, or I have rules or regulations. I have some way of protecting you. That's different for me from saying, "I will be with you." Being with you, for me, is more comforting. It means that God is right here, not around a protection, but God right here, with me, with you. Although we have the assurances, it is not easy to remember that we can turn to God at any time, especially when bad things are happening and we are in panic mode, where we hardly know what to say. We can't even express ourselves because panic has taken over. It does take determination and it does take courage to put oneself totally into God's care, not knowing what the outcome will be. It is so difficult to say, "God, I am so frightened. I give you my fear because I cannot deal with it. I cannot hold it any longer. And I need your peace." When one gives to God voluntarily, not asking God to take the fear, when one gives the fear, one receives the necessary peace to carry on. Now, that feeling of peace might only last for a short time. You might have to go through the exercise again. But each time you go through the exercise, you will feel God's peace within you.